Imagine sitting in Michigan Stadium, affectionately termed the Big House. As one of the largest football stadiums in both the US and the Western Hemisphere, it hosts over 100,000 fans. But here's a perspective. Every year in the United States, the same number of people are on the organ transplant list. Every 10 minutes, someone is added to the list. And tragically, 20 people die each day, waiting for their chance. Annually, this translates to around 42,000 fortunate enough to receive this life-changing surgery, while more than 6,000 never see that day. The current organ supply is meeting less than half of the demand. Adding to the challenge of limited organ availability is the organ matching process. Finding the right match isn't simply about locating a donor. It's a complex alignment of blood type, tissue compatibility, and immunological factors. Even if this medical jigsaw puzzle fits together, those lucky enough to secure an organ today would likely find themselves back on that same wait list in 20 years. Why? Because despite meticulous donor recipient matching, transplants typically only last 5 to 20 years. Over time, the organ is rejected by the immune system. Our immune systems have evolved with a remarkable ability to identify and destroy foreign entities. To slow the rejection process, recipients are prescribed immunosuppressants, drugs that suppress the immune system, for the rest of their lives. These medications are vital for preserving the organ's function, but they also heighten the risk of infection by 2 to 3 times and lead to increased risk of developing cancer. According to a publication in the National Institutes of Health, 40% of kidney transplant recipients, after 2 decades on these medications, received a cancer diagnosis. This means that by the time the average transplant fails, a recipient's likelihood for developing cancer has almost doubled. Let's examine a patient experiencing a common trajectory for people in this situation. Let's call him Michael. At 42, Michael faced the reality of end-stage kidney disease, but was fortunate to receive a transplant in 2003. Fast forward 2 decades, now 62, the same dread resurfaces as his transplant shows signs of failure. Michael is now back on the organ transplant list and receiving dialysis treatments. To add to his challenges, he's also recently been diagnosed with a tumor in his left lung, likely a result of his extended use with immunosuppressants, the very medication intended to save him. With advancing age and declining health, Michael's chances for a second transplant are unfortunately diminishing. But what if there was a solution? A future where waiting for a transplant is a thing of the past. When I was young, I was intensely curious about how things in nature and technology worked. I'd often pester my father with a barrage of, "But why? But why? But why?" Wanting to understand things like, "Why can a starfish regenerate its arms if people can't?" Or, "Why can my dad's computer answer all of my questions even though he can't?" Our parents know everything, don't they? When I wasn't bothering my parents with questions, I spent most of my childhood tinkering with engines alongside my grandfather. Amidst the grease and tools, I learned an essential lesson. Sometimes, you just have to replace the broken part. It's a lesson that has echoed profoundly throughout my life, especially when I started working in healthcare. My journey through the clinical field, evolving from a high school intern to a nurse's assistant, and later a clinical researcher, brought me closer to patients, experiencing both their suffering and their relief. My experiences consistently led me to one conclusion, Our clinical teams need better tools to treat disease with. Did you know that more than 60% of patients do not reap the intended benefits from their prescribed medications? That's a story for a different TED Talk. Learning this truth made me feel helpless. I felt like I had to do something more. I wanted to find new treatment options instead of prescribing less effective ones. So I made a change. I shifted from clinical work to medical device research, focusing on a dialysis machine. I was amazed by our progress in mimicking our body's natural functions. And yet, even with all our progress, modern therapeutic technologies are primitive compared to nature's complex architecture. The dialysis machine I worked on, essentially an artificial kidney, was about as tall as me. Your human kidney is about the size of your fist. How did Mother Nature come up with such a compact blueprint? Modern technology doesn't even come close. I kept thinking, what if we could make new parts for people? Just like when my grandfather had to buy a new carburetor for the lawnmower we were fixing. You can imagine my excitement when I discovered the tissue engineering field. Now, as a pioneer in the cell therapy research environment, with a master's in industrial biomedical science, I am so grateful to be contributing to the massive collaborative effort that is the tissue engineering industry. And here is my team. Thank you. I want to share with you today the power, transformative power of lab-grown human tissues and the future of healthcare. Deep within our adult tissues, stem cells work diligently to replace dying and damaged cells. Their role is vital for wound healing and growth, but their natural ability to repair damage is quite limited. For anyone here who has a scar, you know that sometimes the job is just too big for our stem cells' natural healing abilities. In the lab, we've taken this healing power a step further. We've been able to produce tissues like skin, cartilage, and blood vessels using stem cells taken from the very patient the product is intended for. So how does this magic happen? Let's break each step down together. First, we create a scaffold. Picture a scaffold as the steel framework of a skyscraper, providing the support, structure, and shape needed for the cells to be securely positioned. 3D printing and electrospinning are currently the leading techniques for creating scaffolds. For those who aren't familiar with 3D printers, they build three-dimensional structures by layering materials one on top of the other. The really exciting thing about 3D printed scaffolds is that they can be made using a person's MRI. You know that scan your doctor may have given you to diagnose your injury? Or in this case, my injury. That very scan can be uploaded to a computer and 3D printed into a scaffold that aligns seamlessly with your own unique anatomy. The challenge, however, is that 3D printed materials are synthetic and prone to rejection. To address this issue, electrospun scaffolds closely mirror the natural tissue environment, which enhances cell growth and increases the chance of successful tissue integration for the recipient. These scaffolds are made by pushing a protein solution through a syringe, which is then dispersed in midair using electricity. Picture the process like spinning cotton candy. But instead of gathering heaps of sugary delight on a paper stick, we weave a delicate web of proteins on a flat sheet. The challenge with this method is that electrospun scaffolds are limited to simple shapes, without any of the complex structure provided by 3D printers. Next, we add our patient's stem cells onto the scaffold. Much like tiny seeds sprouting in fertile soil, the cells naturally expand to occupy all of the space available to them, all on their own. Our role as scientists in the lab is to ensure they are happy and healthy as they grow. This is where bioreactors come into play. Has anyone been to the spa recently? Bioreactors are a lot like a spa for the cell, adjusting things like temperature, humidity, and oxygen, ensuring they have the perfect conditions for growth. While the cells are growing inside of this bioreactor, we feed them with a liquid food called media. We can even tell the stem cells to turn into specific types of cells by adding growth factors to this media. Growth factors are chemical signals which direct the cells, determining their identity and role within the tissue. You can think of growth factors as the managerial team, responsible for assigning the stem cells their new job. At this stage of the process, our tissue product looks and feels something like cranberry sauce. We simply have a mass of cells sitting on a scaffold. In order to make our tissue product functional, we have to train the cells on how to perform their new job. And we do this by squishing or stretching them, depending on the tissue we're trying to make. Yeah, I know, you're all probably thinking, Nick, you're telling me that our cells respond to being squished and stretched? As a matter of fact, they do, in the same way that weightlifting conditions our bones and muscles to grow stronger. The technical term for squishing and stretching is mechanical stimulation, and it's the final layer of guidance in the tissue transformation process. You can think of mechanical stimulation as the on-the-job training, which enables cells to align, coordinate, and synergize with their cellular teammates. The combination of these innovative techniques and technologies lay the foundation for lab-grown human tissues that are anatomically true to form, compatible with patient physiology, and functional for a lifetime. Before a new tissue product can be put on the market, it first has to be tested on people to assess its safety and effectiveness. Which brings us to an example of a tissue product that is currently in clinical trial. NovoCart 3D is a cartilage tissue product being developed by Aesculap Biologics. It is made of a scaffold seeded with the patient's stem cells. That sounds familiar to everyone, right? And it is designed to regenerate damaged cartilage for people suffering with osteoarthritis and severe injury. In case you didn't know, cartilage does not heal on its own. And we currently don't really have any good treatments for damaged cartilage. 28 participants were assessed 2 years after implantation with NovoCart 3D. According to a publication in the National Institutes of Health, they demonstrated an average of 73% recovery. Compared to the 0% recovery when left untreated, these results are compelling, to say the least. The innovative technologies behind products like NovoCart 3D open up a world of possibilities. We've largely focused on civilian medical applications, but the potential benefits for our military personnel and anyone affected by the ravages of war are profound. Injuries that are considered life-threatening or crippling may soon be considered a minor setback. At this point, you might be wondering, Nick, if we can grow tissues, why not entire organs? Well, I'd tell you, it's because the challenges largely lie within the complex nature of biology and the astronomical cost of production. Organs are not just masses of cells. They are masterpieces of biological engineering, meticulously designed over millions of years of evolution. A liver, for instance, performs over 500 functions, and each function is the result of billions of cells working in harmony. Even the production of simpler tissues like skin or cartilage already costs somewhere between $1 and $2.6 billion. When we transition to the creation of intricate organs like the kidneys or liver, the complexity, and by extension, the costs, skyrocket. This price tag underscores the extensive collaboration required to bring these tissue products to life, involving countless researchers, clinical specialists, and regulatory professionals, all dedicated to ensuring the safety and efficacy of these therapies. Despite these challenges, the promise is immense. Imagine a world where organ failure isn't a death sentence, but a mere inconvenience. A world where transplants aren't reliant on finding a compatible donor, but are tailor-made for each individual. In the vastness of Michigan Stadium, representing the tens of thousands waiting for an organ, there is a pressing need for a medical revolution. Every seat stands for hope, for life, and for a future where organ failure and traumatic injury can be met with on-demand tissue products. And here's the beautiful part. The change starts with us. We all have a role in shaping this future. For the students with a passion for science, technology, or medicine, you could be the one to overcome today's limitations and make organ engineering a reality. Every scientific hurdle presents an opportunity for innovation. As potential patients in need of better treatment options, enroll in clinical trials. Your participation grants you access to the latest therapeutic interventions while allowing you to directly contribute to the evolution of healthcare, making history in real time. Every clinical trial propels us closer to revolutionary discoveries and transformative treatments. And for those who find all of this fascinating, but prefer to let the experts take the lead, encourage the brilliant minds around you. Your friend, sibling, or child could be the one pioneering these advancements, and your support and belief can set them on this transformative path. As we sit on the cusp of a new dawn in medicine, where lab-grown human tissues may soon be as common as antibiotics, let's not be mere spectators. Let's be the players, the change makers, and the visionaries. In a stadium filled with challenges, let us all be the champions of hope. Together, we can redefine the limits of medicine.